The Lord be with you. Welcome to online worship, sponsored by Landrum Presbyterian Church, as well as Inman Presbyterian Church in the upstate of South Carolina. My name is Reverend Beth Hoskins. If you would like to support the ministries of either of these churches very quickly, here are the addresses. You can also find them on the InmanPres.org website, the online worship page. This is our time to take care of the business of the world and to get ready to hear God's word. And so if you want to help us spread this word of this service, then share us or like us or comment on YouTube. And also, I invite you to check in with anyone who may be in the room watching this service with you. You might even want to pause it and see how you're doing and share. See if there's anything you'd like people to know, good or bad. These are the prayer concerns for the churches. I flash it up very quickly. Church members will sometimes take screenshots or pictures with their phones and pray for these folks throughout the week. This is our time to put aside those things in the world and to create a sacred space wherever we are, whether you're in your home or your yard or your boat or your car, wherever you are. I invite you to center yourselves on the things of God and bring to your heart and mind those people you'd like to bring with you into this sacred moment. And let us come together in prayer to prepare ourselves to meet the living God in the Word read and proclaimed. Let us pray. O Lord, we pray that you would come and fill the space where we dwell and open our ears and open our minds to hear and receive the good news that you have for us today in this text. And we bring to you those of our sisters and brothers, families and neighbors who have need of you, for whom we hope healing and love and your holy presence. Bless us now to be fully present with you, even as you are fully present with us. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Let us prepare ourselves to hear the word by singing together, Baptized in Water. Hear now the word of the Lord as it comes to us from Psalm 2, verses 7 and 8. Listen for the word of the Lord. I will tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and the ends of the earth your possession." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Today we are in the Gospel of Matthew. It is the baptism of the Lord Sunday at the churches. We're going to be installing and ordaining our officers. They're Presbyterian churches, so they will be ruling elders. That's what we call them. In the Gospel of Matthew, we're still at the beginning, but even in this little bit, we have spent time in the family room looking at the full family tree from Abraham to King David all the way to Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, also known as the Messiah. And there in chapter 2, we were with Daddy Joseph as he received the disturbing news that his young fiancée Mary was pregnant. But the angel came and assured him that this was all of God and was happening exactly as God intended it to happen, and that he need not be afraid to take her as his wife, and that the baby would be called Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins, and he will be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. And Joseph did everything the Lord commanded of him. And the baby was born. And there appeared in the sky a star. And magi, wise men from the east, Gentile scientists, holy men, saw that star and began to follow it to the place where they knew they would find a new king. And their travels led them through Jerusalem, where they got the attention of Herod, right? And Herod is greatly disturbed at the news of the birth of a new king and all Jerusalem with him. And he tries to trick the wise men into scouting out where the baby is so he can find out and go and snuff him out. Because that's the kind of guy Herod is. But God uses an angel to warn them. And the wise men go back to their home by another way. But not before they follow that star all the way to where the baby was, the child. And they rejoice with great joy, we're told. And they bowed down and worshiped him and offered him the finest gifts they had to offer, gold and frankincense and myrrh. Joseph takes his family and flees to Egypt to escape the death squad of Herod, who swoops into Bethlehem and kills all the male children 2 years and younger. And Rachel would be heard weeping for her children because they were no more. And when Joseph got word that Herod was gone and not a threat anymore, he brought his family back out of Egypt, according to the scriptures, as they had foretold. And he settled in a place called Nazareth, where the child would grow up in a loving Jewish home with his mother and father, the carpenter, Mary and Joseph. And the child grew. Until one day, I pick up the reading in chapter 3, verse 1, going through 17. Listen for the word of the Lord. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locust and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say for yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' But I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Even though we're only in chapter 3 in Matthew, we've gone through a whole lot of stuff there in that family room, looking at the whole family tree, there with Daddy Joseph, hearing the angel explain how the birth of Jesus is going to happen exactly like God wants it to happen. With those wise men following the star into Jerusalem, past crazy mean King Herod to Bethlehem to find the child. Being warned by an angel of the Lord not to go back to Jerusalem, but to go home by another way. And with Joseph as he escaped, fled to Egypt with his family to avoid the evil of Herod killing all the children, 2 years old and younger, who were male in Bethlehem. And eventually coming back to Nazareth to settle down and raise his family when it was safe. That's a lot of goings on, isn't it? That's a lot of calamity. But today, the scripture is inviting us to come and rest from all that calamity. And don't we love that after Advent and Christmas and New Year's? Sometimes it's just time to rest. And so the scripture is inviting us to come together to the river. Out there in the country where things move at a slower pace. Can you hear the breeze in the trees? Can you see the beauty of the wildlife? And hear the sound of water running over rocks and sand? The scripture is inviting us to come and go down to the river where a man named John the Baptist is waiting for us. It's calm down by that river. It's out in the country, away from the busyness of the city. And John calls you to come away from your everyday troubles and find your way to him. there in that river. He invites you to come and look into its waters and see your reflection there. And he invites you to see yourself in that wavery light of that water. Not as the world sees you. Not as your family sees you, or your friends, or your colleagues, or your neighbors, or even in your own eyes. John the Baptist invites you to see yourself as God sees you. God who sees beyond any mask we hold up to the world. God who is perfect in love and truth and righteousness and faithfulness. Come to the river, beckons John. Come to the river and look and see the ways of God and repent, for the kingdom of heaven has drawn near, preaches John. Repent. We use that word repent in church. You don't usually hear it in other places. You can, but it's unusual. It's a church word, right? I think most people, when they hear that word repent, they think of something like a time when they were young and they got caught smacking a brother or sister. Maybe your mama is walking by and catches you and pulls you and says, "Now you look at him or her and you say you're sorry and you mean it, mister." And so you look at your sibling and you say, "I'm sorry." Not because you're sorry, really, but probably because you're sorry you got caught. Because you don't want to be punished, or you just want to get on with your day or something. Repent, says John the Baptist. And some of us are hearing that as say you're sorry, even though we aren't sure exactly what we have done wrong or what to be sorry about. But when you're looking at that sibling who you've smacked, and the words come out of your mouth, sometimes you see that person and you realize, I hurt him. And I do love him or her, even though she messes with my stuff. I love him. And I am sorry. Repent, says John the Baptist. Look at the God who is perfect in love and mercy and truth and righteousness and justice. Look at this God. See your reflection in this God and say you're sorry. Repent. Of course, there are other ways to think about repent. It's a meta and vu. Two Greek words, to change, meta to change, and vus, one's mind. To change one's mind, to adopt another view, or change one's feelings. You could hear repent as all of these things. Reminds me when you maybe were a teenager and wanted to play with your friends, but the family dragged you away to go to some family event. And so you go and you sulk and you mope and you act like such a jerk that everybody's trip is ruined, right? Until somebody comes to you and loves on you so much that you can't help but love back just a little. And in spite of yourself, you find yourself maybe laughing a little or joining in a little, having a good time. You've changed your mind, your attitude, your feelings are different. Things go better. Repent. Change your attitude, says John. Or maybe you can hear repent like when you witness something and it changes your perception. And you understand something you didn't understand before, and your mind is opened, and your spirit is opened, and your heart is opened. This can happen sometimes, too. I tell you a story from my own life. In my hometown of Rock Hill, going to high school football games was big. It was big, especially since my big brother played on the high school football team. And so the family would go, and the parents would pick their seat, and then they would release the kids to go and play as long as they knew that they came back before the end of the game to that seat so we could leave together and go home. This was the covenant, right? You released to go play with your friends. And so you left and you went and found your friends and you talked and you played. And on this night, I went to the concession stand in front of which there was a big patch of grass and there were a lot of kids playing a chase kind of game. And I didn't know any of the kids, but I joined in. And it turns out that one of those kids was a classic bully. Yeah, he was a couple of years older than me and he was bigger. And he had smaller cronies who obeyed his every whim. The classic bully, you know. And for some reason this night, his attention turned to me. I was smaller and nobody knew me in that crowd. And I remember him making very ugly remarks about me that made the others laugh. And he began to move towards me in a very threatening way. And I was frightened and ready to bolt. And just about that moment, my dad showed up. He wanted to leave the game early, so he came looking for me so we could leave. And as he was walking towards us, I'm sure he saw all the drama that was happening between this kid and me. And he walked straight up to the kid who was holding a drink. And he said, "Hey, what's that?" He pointed at his drink, and that kid looked in there like this. And then my dad took his hand, and he popped the bottom of that cup, and all of its contents splashed all over his face. And all the kids laughed at him. And before he knew what to do, he grabbed me by the hand and said, "Come on, we're going home now." And we got in the car, and we went home. And as we're driving home, and I thought about what had happened, I realized that this big, scary man who made me do a lot of things I didn't like, you know, that's what dads do. They make you do the right things, right? In that moment, I also realized it was a big, scary man who was there to protect me, even from bullies. And something shifted. And I saw him differently. And we got along better. Matthew is very clear that baby who's born and put in the manger is going to be called Emmanuel. And Emmanuel means literally God is with us. And this baby is going to be named Jesus, which literally means Savior, for he will save his people from their sins. This changes everything. To know that God, who is big and scary, holy and just, righteous in every way, is on your side, wants what is best for you, is sending someone to you to help and rescue you from yourself if necessary. This understanding, this perspective changes everything. Repent, says John. Change the way you see and experience God. For the kingdom of heaven has come near. And lo and behold, standing before him is none other than Jesus himself asking to be baptized. But Jesus has done nothing wrong to say he's sorry. He already has a loving spirit and knows who God is. John doesn't want to do it. "Me baptize you," he says. "You should be baptizing me." It's proper, says Jesus, to fulfill all righteousness. It's proper what we're doing. And so John does it. He baptizes Jesus there in the river. And Jesus shows us another reason for being baptized. Connection. Holy connection. For when he came up out of that water, the heavens were open to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And he heard that voice from heaven saying to him, "This is my son, my boy, the one I love, with whom I am well pleased." That connection would never be broken. Never. It would be the juice that powered Jesus' ministry from beginning to end and all places in between. His ministry, which is going to start in the very next story, after his great testing in the wilderness. He goes straight from here, and the Spirit leads him to the wilderness to be tested, and after that, he begins his ministry. Jesus would hear the voice say almost exactly the same thing during his transfiguration a few chapters away from here. "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him," he says, for Peter has stuck his foot in his mouth. "Listen to him, bonehead. Come on. Pay attention." Jesus would never forget or question the truth of who he is, the beloved Son of God, who was and is so very pleased with him. So many of our spiritual failures in this life, yea, maybe all of them, come when we question or doubt or don't believe that God could possibly claim us as his children. Us, with all of our flaws and weaknesses and failures. Sometimes we question or we doubt that we are truly beloved of God. But we are, because that's why Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, came to this world in the first place. That we would know what it is like to be called the beloved of God. Children of the Most High. John is calling to you, my friend, calling to you to come to the river today and telling you to repent. Say you're sorry. Come to your senses and realize that God is for you and not against you. Give in. Give in to God's love. Just say yes to God. Let yourself be loved and forgiven. "Repent," says John, "for the man from Galilee, the beloved Son of God, the kingdom of heaven has come near to you here today." Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, open our hearts and our minds and our lives and our souls to the truth that you love us in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and you claim us. And you help us to become that which we think is impossible. Holy, loving, faithful. Bless us now in the name of the risen Lord to hear your voice telling us one more time that we are your beloved children. Help us to live as those who are claimed and named and sent forth in the name of our risen Lord. In His name, amen. Let us sing together a hymn, Here I Am, Lord.
I am the same.
I hope you take time today to take a deep breath and let your soul breathe. And let yourself rest in the presence of the Holy God who loves you, that you may be renewed and your ears would be open to hear the voice of the one calling you by name, because you are so beloved. And as you go back into your world, take the love of God with you and remember to share it with others. For when you do that, you give praise to God's holy name. Go in peace, my friends.